And although nominated justices come before the Senate Judiciary Committee and the Senate and swear that their views on abortion and the death penalty and gun rights will not affect how they rule, they don't rule in an ivory tower. And judges do make policy. And yes, they interpret the law, but they interpret it through their own political lenses. So I think that's important.
Let's go to that clip that is being played everywhere of Judge Sotomayor speaking at a conference in 2005. It's available on YouTube. It's been played repeatedly on the networks in the last day. In it, Judge Sotomayor says, quote, "A court of appeals is where policy is made." Well, she's now coming under criticism from some Republican lawmakers for the comment. Well, I want to play a slightly longer version of what she had to say. She was at Duke University, where she goes on to clarify this statement.
All of the legal defense funds out there, they're looking for people with court of appeals experience because it is, court of appeals is where policy is made. And I know this is on tape and I should never say that because we don't make law, I know. I know. I'm not promoting it and I'm not advocating it, Having said that, the Court of Appeals is where, before the Supreme Court makes the final decision, the law is percolating. Its interpretation, its application. And Judge Lucero is right. I often explain to people, when you're on the district court, you're looking to do justice in the individual case. So you are looking much more to the facts of the case than you are to the application of the law, because the application of the law is non-precedential. So the facts control. On the Court of Appeals, you are looking to how the law is developing so that it will then be applied to a broad class of cases. And so you're always thinking about the ramifications of this ruling on the next step in the development of the law. You can make a choice and say, I don't care about the next step, and sometimes we do. Or sometimes we say, we'll worry about that when we get to it. Look at what the Supreme Court just did. But the point is that that's the differences.
Judge Sotomayor, Tom Goldstein, your reaction.
I do think that this quote, this one sentence, has been really played far too much out of context. I'm glad you've given the broader context. It's an indication that those who are attacking her have not much to work with, that they focus on this one sentence in a panel where she's kind of making a light joke about, you know, something that's absolutely realistic, as your other guest said, that on some level there are so many holes in the law and ambiguities in the law that you can't ignore the fact that there's some policymaking made at the Court of Appeals level. And then there's this one sentence from a law review article that's taken from a speech she did out at Berkeley. And, you know, when you have somebody who has a career of 11 years, I don't think the public's going to think much of, you know, what she said in these ones individual sentences.
I'd like to bring back Juan Manuel Garcia Paz Alacua on both this issue of judicial activism in the federal courts, as well as, again, going back to Judge Sotomayor's own history. I mentioned in my column in the Daily News today the particular irony of Judge Sotomayor being named to the Supreme Court, because it was the Supreme Court that, in effect, legalized the holding of colonies by the United States government back in the early 20th century in what's been known as the insular cases most Americans are not aware of. But now you have the daughter of colonial subjects, in effect, her parents, now being named to that very court. Could you go over some of those, what those insular cases represented in terms of judicial activism by the Supreme Court itself?
Juan, this is a crucial issue that I think the United States should address through your program from today on. Judge Sotomayor is not a daughter of the American Revolution, okay? Judge Sotomayor was a member of the board of directors of the Puerto Rican Legal Defense Fund, which meant three things. Number one, that she was an ethnic national, a Puerto Rican. Number two, that she felt that ethnic Puerto Ricans deserved and needed a defense. And third, that she dedicated 12 years of her life to that defense, the defense of the Puerto Rican ethnicity within the United States of America. So in that sense, you're absolutely correct in your column today. This is a child of colonialism. This is a woman that is a member of the Supreme Court of the United States because the United States invaded her country, and as a matter of fact, took her parent to war, but that's another issue. The issue is, as you pose it, the issue is the irony of it all that deserves to be discussed is how the daughter of the Bronx gets to be a Supreme Court justice in a colonial relationship between her country and the United States of America. It's going to be a long dialogue, let me tell you. I think we're going to be talking about this for years.
But those Supreme Court insular cases, could you summarize for our listeners and viewers what they involved?
Okay, I'm sorry. The insular cases decided in 1917, the United States Congress granted American citizenship to all those persons born in Puerto Rico. And the Supreme Court in 1922 decided that granting American citizenship to Puerto Ricans did not incorporate Puerto Rico into the American Union on the way to statehood, and created something called the unincorporated territory, which is what Puerto Rico is now, according to the insular cases, precisely Balzac versus Puerto Rico, that was decided in 1922. The fascinating thing is that, again, an entity, an island, 8 million people, 4 million in Puerto Rico, 4 million in the United States. Let's call it a people. 8 million people are part of an unincorporated relationship to the United States at a moment in which the President of the United States appoints Justice of the Supreme Court of the United States, one of those people of the unincorporated territory has been appointed Supreme Court Justice. Fascinating. I assure you, Juan, that your book about the consequences of imperialism will have to be reissued after the discussions around the nomination of Sonia Sotomayor go around the block, as they are going to go around the block for months.
I'd also like to ask Cesar Perales, one of the early cases that Puerto Rican Legal Defense and Education Fund took up when Sotomayor was on your board was the famous Helena Valentin versus Koch case. I think it was 1981, when a series of lawsuits over the elections, local elections in New York